Yes, so I'm Graham. I'm the founder of Player Research. And I, before that, I was an academic in human-computer interaction at a UK university. But I left that maybe 5 years ago to found and start Player Research, to try and take the academic discipline of HCI, or human-computer interaction, and bring that knowledge into the video game industry, really. In particular, the development process, so how they make games. Yeah, pretty much. So, I mean, this term UX comes in different names. So you could say UX research or design research. And I think I like the term design research because it links together the design process with the research of the design. So in the past, you know, the companies were designing games, they weren't often checking the design, let's say. There's different ways of doing that. So the research behind the design. How did you know you got it right? So people like Sid Meier, one of the world's greatest game designers, when he comes up with an idea, he says, you know, I don't know if I got it right. It's only if the player says so that I know I got it right. So here's one of the greats basically saying, I don't know, I can't decide if a design is brilliant. It's only if the player says so. So this process of UX research basically says, well, does the player say so? You've got an idea, but let's figure out if the player also can find the fun in this game. So that's what we do. We try and help designers see their game from the player's viewpoint. I think they're all useful is the short answer, because they're useful at different stages of development. So if a company comes to us during the concept stage, or during design, or during production, or post-launch, we may use different methods at different times. But our most popular method, I would say, is one called the expert review, or UX expert review, where instead of bringing players in to assess the game, two of our staff would do it. And the reason why that's arguably the most popular one for us is because you can do it at any stage. You know, as long as you've got something there, a grey box prototype or an early design, or maybe your game has been released for 5 years or 10 years, this method is very versatile. So that's what makes it the most popular. The gold standard really is, of course, players. You know, the usability playtest, or UX playtest. So bringing people in to play your game, arguably that's the best, because that's who your game's for, you know. But that's harder, it's a little bit less popular, because it only applies at certain specific stages. Is your game ready to test, for example? So it's better, but maybe not as versatile a method. I don't know if there is. This is a terrible answer, perhaps. But those layers that I showed, where, you know, games are failing at teaching the player, like learnability is poor, or usability is poor. I think most companies fail at those layers. So I was saying, for example, it's not that the game idea is bad; it's just the implementation of the idea. And I think that's where companies fail an awful lot. So our reports would often contain a lot of issues around. You haven't taught the player very well, or they don't understand how to play your game, or the controls are clumsy, or the feedback's poor. So their ability to learn the game and correct their behavior is quite weak. We often see games fail in those particular layers. But there's no specifics, because it'll depend on the genre or things like that. But generally speaking, the learnability or the usability are often areas that we would comment on heavily across all platforms, all games, things like that. That's a tricky one, because obviously smaller companies arguably may not have as much resource. And resource could mean time or money or access to people. So you would imagine that the bigger companies who have lots of people like us in-house would consistently produce the best games. And maybe that's not true. That's the interesting thing, that just because you've got great researchers finding all these issues, there could be a cultural problem in the studio that means we know this is a problem, but maybe it doesn't get fixed. So it's hard to isolate one problem. And we were talking about UX maturity, saying, well, you can have a UX mature company. They know the value, they invest heavily in it, they've dedicated labs, they've dedicated people. That's not enough, because then you've got the cultural problem, or, but are you going to make a change? And are you doing the right method at the right time? So it's very hard to pinpoint and say, you know, bigger companies will have more chance of producing success. Maybe it's a combination of things, like your willingness to learn or to take feedback. I think there was a mixture of people in the class today, so maybe they're programmers or designers or UX people. I'm not sure which piece, looking back, I'm trying to think what's the most useful thing I would say to students. I think for me it comes back to the process. You know, if you're a game designer or a programmer especially, that you really should trust that process. It sounds very simple, but take the time to understand. Don't just jump straight in and start programming or start designing. And I think you'll produce better designs and better code if you take the time to understand what's the lessons I can learn from those who came before me. Why is this interaction not satisfying to use? Why is this not the best method of feedback? Why do people praise this mechanism? Why is it? You know, take the time to really understand it until you can decompose it no more. Short examples of controls going down to individual taps, for example. And very few people would take the time to understand, you know, break it down into that level of detail. But the good thing is, if you do that, especially for interaction design, it can produce beautiful, fluid, and satisfying control schemes. So not all this information is there if you want it. So I think awareness is also important. Know all the methods available. I'm not saying be an expert in them all, but just know what your options could be. I'm aware that I could do these things. Because if you're not aware, then it stops there, right? You'll never do it. So in UX maturity, is you could talk about what level a company is in. But if you aren't even aware of the UX methods or UX research as a thing, then how are you going to get to the higher levels if you can't even get off the bottom of the ladder, you know? So, I think take the time to have a good overview of what's possible. And a lot of game studios, even the most famous game studios, they don't all know what they could have done. That's a shame, because the right method at the right time could have massively benefited everyone.